all revved up today to make a video because if I had known these tips 5 years ago, I could have put so much more money in my pocket. And so if you're a small business owner, an entrepreneur, a contractor, self-employed, do you know your numbers? So before we dive into today's topic, which is the 7 biggest mistakes that most small business owners and entrepreneurs make when it comes to knowing your numbers, I'm Megan Marsh, co-host of the CoLab podcast and the CoLab community. Welcome to our channel. Down in the description, we would love to have you join us on our podcast, where we're all about sharing with you information as small business owners who have opened multiple businesses, the tips and tricks and resources, and just the things that we've learned to make you a better business owner, put more money in your pocket, and help you grow and succeed in your business. Oh, and also make sure you subscribe to our channel. Click on that bell so you get notifications so you can continue to build your business by learning from other people who have been there and done it before. And we'd also love to hear from you on your best tip or trick in business that's helping you thrive and grow. So today's topic is the 7 biggest mistakes that we've made and we've heard other business owners have made that keeps them from putting more money in your pocket. And I think when we all start a business, we all, you know, imagine what it's going to be like, all the money we're going to make. And if you've seen any of the statistics, if you've heard about any of them, the average person who owns a business makes less than $75,000. It's like we don't take on all this stress and we don't do all the things and pour our heart and soul into our business not to reap the rewards of what we are putting all that risk on the line. So let's start out and start understanding where you can avoid some of these mistakes. And the first one just starts out, it's pretty general. It's number one is understanding your numbers, okay? And what I'm talking about here is the fundamentals, not really the numbers, because the numbers part, if you're not a numbers person, which a lot of business owners aren't, you either are a fantastic photographer or you're a really great attorney or, you know, whatever business that you have, you know your business, you're passionate about the people that you help. And when someone starts talking about numbers, you probably are like, that's what my accountant's for. That's what the person who does my books. But if I could give you one tip, it's understanding the fundamentals behind what your business is and how it runs. So for example, in my main service business, we do loans. So we have to understand people, what they are. Are you a Schedule C? Are you a Schedule E? Do you have a separate business tax return? How much money do you make? What is your revenue? How much do you make and get taxed on? That's what I mean by understanding your numbers. And you don't need to understand it like your CPA does, but you need to be able to advocate for yourself. Because advocating for yourself, it's really the core fundamental thing that will help you in every other area. Because you don't want to be one of those businesses that fail in the first 3 to 5 years. And there's a lot of them. And one of the number one reasons is cash flow. So start just piece by piece understanding what type of a business you are and start wrapping your head around some of the different numbers in your business. Tip number 2 is picking the right professionals for your business. When I started out owning my first business, you don't really know who to turn to for advice, for services. And what I found in my case was I spent way too much money on things that I might not have needed or there was a better option. And so, you know, that's where you need to do your research and your homework. Most of the things you're spending money on as a small business, it's bigger ticket items than you do for yourself at home or your family. I'll give you one example. When I had my first business, I knew we needed a website. And so I went out and found someone locally to create a website. And yeah, it was a great website, but it cost us a good, let's say, $5,000. And when we had to change that website, it was on I don't even know enough about websites, but it was on this type of server that I couldn't then have someone take over who was on our team now because it wasn't on a general platform like WordPress. And so really being selective with the professionals that help you, I always like to go and find out who owns their own business, who are they using? Because if you're working with another business owner, they're going to be a little more cognizant of, you know, if you're bootstrapping your business or if you're outsourcing it or if you need to do it yourself. And so start looking for different professionals that you're using who are self-employed themselves and understand what you're going through so that you can look at different options and pick someone that will help you grow and make it easier for you as you move forward and try to grow your business. And then tip number three is treating the bank that you pick like they're a general doctor, like it's a family practitioner. And what I mean by that is, you know, when you go off and you decide to start a business, it's a different form of getting money, right? And what I see a lot of people who are small business owners or entrepreneurs do is they pick bank A, and that's the bank that they deposit all their money in, okay? And what happens is they have this relationship with this bank and they go to that bank for everything. Their mortgage, their bank accounts, their everything. And all of a sudden you get stuck because that bank that you do your banking with might not have the mortgage product that you need, or maybe they don't invest in, they don't have an investor who, you know, puts your money where you want it. When you are working with a bank is just one piece of the puzzle. A bank is fantastic for where you hold your deposits, your bank accounts. They're like a general doctor. If you have a family or you get sick, you have a cold, you have tonsillitis, you go to your family doctor. But when you start needing financially more specialized products and things like a mortgage, like your investments, I highly recommend that you then go to people who work specifically with self-employed borrowers. So don't treat your bank that you do your deposits and write your checks out of like they are the all-knowing. Make sure you're continuing to find the expertise that you need outside of your bank. Tip number four, if you have a team, if you have an office location that's outside of your home, one of the other biggest mistakes I see people make is not considering purchasing your own building. It's kind of the same thing when I meet families who have been renting for 5 years or 10 years. They never build up that equity and that wealth foundation that someone does when they purchase a home, because you're building equity, you're paying yourself. And I think a lot of that, because I made this mistake, is that we think we need a lot of money as a business owner to purchase a building. When I bought the building I'm sitting in right now, I ended up needing to put 20% down because I made the mistake of going to my bank, like the general doctor, like we just talked about. Well, now that I've been in a small business owner and I understand more what's out there, you can buy a building for your business and put as little as zero down. Zero. You can buy a commercial building like this that I'm in. If I had known, I could have put nothing down. And as a small business owner, putting down 50, 60, 70,000, sometimes that's everything we have in our bank account. So keeping that capital in your account is so important, but so is building that equity and having something besides your service, besides your product, that's helping you build up cash flow, equity, and just building that financial foundation. Number five, not reviewing your financials monthly. As a small business owner, a lot of times in the beginning, we want to save money, right? I get it. We're bootstrapping, so maybe we're doing our own QuickBooks, and then we just have somebody who does our taxes for us, right? But if taxes and books are not your thing, you're going to fall behind, or they're not going to be accurate. And maybe you even have made the mistake that I made, which is I had the wrong professional doing my helping us with bookkeeping and taxes, and I never could get a financial statement when the month ended. It would take months to get a financial statement. So finding that right professional allowed me now, by the 10th of every month, we have a financial statement, a profit and loss, that we can look at, and our leadership team sits down monthly and we look at that profit and loss. And do you want to know what happened when we started doing this? We started identifying areas where we were spending too much, or we started identifying areas that we could save money. we started identifying things that we could cut out. Sometimes you all have employees that you didn't even realize I signed up for some accounts and they may have even forgotten. So looking at your financials monthly is gonna help you really stay sharp on what you need as a business, what you're wasting money on, where you can save money, and it'll just make you a lot more conscious of the decisions you're making so you can put more money in your pocket. And then number six, this is also a very common one, and it's thinking that what you have in your bank account is what's running your business. And I know it seems like, okay, I'm looking at my bank account. I've got 50,000, 100,000 in my bank account. So I've got enough money to do this and that. That is a huge mistake because we all know in business, we have a lot of checks going out and we have a lot of checks coming in all the time. You can't go by the balance in your bank account. That's the quickest way to all of a sudden have nothing. If you, let's say you have payroll in your business, all of a sudden that payroll can take you down to hardly anything and you're not really looking at the cash flow of your business. Now, if you are gonna look at your bank balances, then each month slowly transfer money over to an account you're not touching and that will give you a buffer. But really it's running your financial statements, your cash flow, your profit and loss. That's what's going to tell you how much money you have to work with to spend on anything that you want to use in your business. And then last but not least, number seven is knowing your KPIs. Do you know what a KPI is? I didn't either. It's your key performance indicators. It's the numbers that are most important to you in your business. And so that could be things like, how many widgets do I need to sell to be profitable? So what's my break-even number? Do I need to sell 10 widgets to break even and pay all my expenses? Or do I need to sell 4 widgets? In our main business, for example, we do mortgages. And the average amount, let's say, that we bring in on a mortgage that our company makes, let's say it was $3,000. Well, as the business owner, you know, I figured if our average was 3,000 and we had a bigger sale on a bigger loan and we were making 4,000, for example, but we got shown by a financial specialist that it didn't matter. Our KPIs are what told us you can't make less than this percentage. You have to bring in this many. If you're going to hire people, you need to be closing so much. And it's those key indicators that tell you how you're doing. So at any given time, you can tell if you're going to make enough in a given month, in a given quarter, or in a year. It just really helps you stay. It gives you the warm and fuzzies when you start learning your KPIs. And we're going to do another video on KPIs. And just kind of to round it out, where I started learning more about these KPIs is by starting to be around other small business owners, starting to learn from them, starting to hear their best practices, because I'm sure as you have heard in this video, I've made mistakes. I have spent so much money on the websites, professionals that weren't able to help me, putting 20% down on a building when I could have left the money in my bank account. And so, you know, all those mistakes are learning lessons, but hopefully one of these tips could help you not make that same mistake. And if you are in a situation, any of the ones that I've gone over, and you're like, you know what, I don't get my financials by the 10th, or I did go to just my bank for this. This is where you can start exploring, but it's also why I just wanted to invite you once again to down, there's a link down in the description to go and click on the link and subscribe. Go listen to our podcast where we're going to continue to give you information on the mistakes we've made, on the best practices that have helped us grow our teams, grow our profits, but especially grow our bottom lines. Because as business owners, it doesn't matter how much you bring in, it's how much you take home and how much you're able to give back to your teams so that you have a business that continues to thrive and grow. And it's worth it. It's worth it at the end of the day, all the hard work, all the risk, all the reward, and it all comes down to knowing your numbers. So thank you so much for joining me here at the CoLab. Make sure once again that you hit the bell, that you subscribe so that you can get notifications when our next video is coming out. I can't wait to see you on the next one.